What is your actual favorite molecular motor, though? We've talked about all these different ones. What's your favorite?
Well, we've talked about some rather amazing ones, but probably the most amazing to me is one called topoisomerase, which is a big word. Sounds very complex, and it is.
Well, it does sound complex, so tell me more.
There's actually two types of topoisomerase, and these are present in all living things, bacteria, humans, everything in between.
Mm.
And topoisomerase has an absolutely essential function in all living things. And it's got to do with the fact that our DNA is a double helix, so it's twisted like this.
Mm-hmm.
So to read it, you need to untwist it.
Right, sort of like opening a book, you've got to untwist.
Well, not a book so much as you think about a rope. Oh, I've got a piece of string here. I can sort of illustrate the issue.
Would you say it's like the equivalent, though, of us opening a book and reading what's inside?
That's like that with the DNA. You've got to open the book to read it. That's right. But in the process of untwisting the DNA so you can read one of the strands, imagine that's the two strands of the DNA, and we start to untwist it, and we get so far, I don't want to go any further.
Yeah, it's all...
Because it's twisted up and it's actually tangled. In fact, if we let go, see how it's actually twisted up and tangled?
Yeah, it wants to sort of retwist itself.
It wants to fold back on itself and twist up. And the DNA does that. And so what does a cell do? Because if this happened, that'd be the end. There's no reproduction. It can't reproduce the DNA. Not even bacteria can do it because it'll twist the same. So it has this topoisomerase actually fixes the problem.
Before we continue, a quick heads up. Stick around to the end of the interview because we'll be giving away a free stream of our award-winning documentary, Evolution's Achilles' Heels. You won't want to miss it. Now back to the interview. And how does it fix that problem?
Well, I only talk about type 2. Type 2 is the most interesting one. But type 2 wraps itself around the DNA and actually cuts the DNA, double-stranded, and actually the twisted loop, it feeds back through the cut, and then it actually reseals the DNA, rejoins it.
Right.
And this amazing topoisomerase enzyme motor does that job. And so it's got a top part which opens, it's got a bottom part which opens, and it's got a middle section which does the cutting and joining, and it lets the two strands of the DNA in each side, cuts it, feeds it through, and then rejoins it, and then lets it out.
So that is to, in fact, negate the knots that keep
forming.
It
detangles the DNA.
It's detangling it as it goes.
It's a detangling enzyme, yes.
Isn't that amazing? That's so amazing because that's, in fact, so necessary for the DNA to be untangled.
There's no life without it.
And that's just casually going along and doing that every time a cell divides.
Yeah.
Wow.
And it uses ATP.
And there you go. Yet another nano machine that has to use ATP to function.
Yeah.
So if topoisomerase is so necessary for life, for a self-producing cell, how could life have even started then?
No, it couldn't. It could not have started without super, super intelligent design, putting things together. I mean, the things we're talking about today, clever scientists have worked out how they're working to some extent, which is just amazing science. You know, I just love it. I love the science.
It's so fascinating.
It is so fascinating. Working out how God's creation works is just so amazing. Those scientists, clever as they are, could never, ever have dreamt of actually inventing those systems.
Well, they're so complex.
They're so complex. And they come along after the event and work out how they work to the best of our ability. And some very clever science, very clever science, very clever scientists. They could not have ever dreamt of actually designing those things. And yet, sadly, strangely, some of those very scientists go on about evolution, how this evolved or that evolved, you know.
Mm.
It doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, especially with how complex it is and the chances of such complexity having to come together at the same time so it doesn't lose that information is actually useful.
Yeah.
That there's such an infinitesimally small number that, you know, it's almost it feels like it's screaming at you in the face.
That, it's screaming you know, at you. I spoke at a church in Melbourne some years ago, and a young guy came to me afterwards and he said, I'm studying, doing a PhD in molecular biology at the University of Melbourne.
Mm.
And he said, I totally agree with what you, I just said a little bit about these motors in my talk. But he said, I totally agree with you, what you're saying about these things. He said, I cannot understand my colleagues who study this stuff daily and can't see the hand of God.
Yeah.
So it just doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't seem to make sense. And I mean, I know I'm just a regular uni student asking a scientist a bunch of questions, but even to me it seems like that is such an obvious answer. And I mean, it might be a difficult answer to agree with. You know, it has so many implications that if there is intelligent design, there's an intelligent designer, and that actually means a lot for me.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's the problem. I mean, problem is that the science points to an intelligent designer far above us.
Mm.
Who could that be other than the creative God revealed in the Bible?
Mm.
There's no other option, really. So that's the reason there's so much resistance to following the evidence wherever it leads, which is towards, I mean, Romans chapter 1 says that God's attributes are seen in what he's created, so people are without excuse.
Yeah, and here with these nano machines, we see that this is so complex and this has to be the hand of God, that this is almost irrefutable evidence for that.
I would say in today's world, the people with the least excuse for believing in God are people studying this stuff, the molecular biologists who are studying this stuff.
So, Don, we have a documentary that you want to tell us about. What have you got to show us?
So it's Evolution's Achilles Heels. There's 8 chapters, but there's 15 PhD scientists who explain why cosmic evolution from the beginning of the universe to the origin of life and the diversity of life and the meaning and purpose of life, all covered. It's a very, very entertaining, really high quality, lots of animations and on-site footage and things in it. It's divided into chapters, so you can sort of just watch a little bit at a time if you want to take it in slowly, but really highly recommended.
And this is actually a free stream with the link in the description if you guys want to go check that out. Don, thanks for your time yet again. Thank you for walking us through some of these nanomachines that are in our cells. It's genuinely just some of the most fascinating stuff I've ever heard. Thank you for all the work you do.
That's been my pleasure. It's been my pleasure. Thanks, James.